So this is going to take you through the second level of After Effects, still working with the very basic functions of After Effects, but getting a little bit more creative and a little more playful here. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to work with solids and shapes. And those seem similar at first, but they have some different properties, and we're going to talk about how to play with those different properties. The second thing we're going to do is look at effects on solids. So we're going to actually look at how effects work in After Effects. And we're only going to look at three here, although there's dozens to choose from. Tint, gradient, and grid. We're going to look at effects on copy, and that would be tint and gradient as well, and then bevel. And then we're going to look at animating effects, and that would be, again, through tint and gradient, and then numbers, so how to make something look like it's counting up. And then, of course, we're going to play with some of the really fun stuff with After Effects, which are presets. So you might be able to customize these to some degree, but I just want to show you that they're there, and you can play with them and make them into whatever you want them to be to have some really incredible professional effects in these presentations or in these videos. So the first thing we're going to do here is look at creating a second composition. You can see this is the same file that I was in before, which is called aepracticum.aep. And my composition is called sample for class, right? But I actually don't want to work in this composition. I want to leave it as is, and we're going to talk about why later. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to actually go to a composition and create a new composition. And I'm going to call this sample for class 2, and then in parentheses, shapes. And notice that this one is 20 seconds, not 30 seconds. So I'm going to click OK. And you can see how it's added it to my bin here. So I've got regular sample for class and sample for class 2 shapes. And it appears down here. So actually, you can see both my first composition and my second one. I'm going to change the name of this so it stays consistent. So I'm going to do sample for class 1. And this is copy. And then I only want to work in sample for class 2 shapes. And we're going to learn more about this as we go, but really what this suggests is that we can actually embed one composition into another composition, and that's what we're going to learn how to do. So the first thing I want to show you guys to do in this case is to work with different kinds of shapes or different ways of thinking about shapes. So when you go up to the top menu here, you can see this little square, and the little triangle at the bottom corner says that if I click and hold, it's going to give me a bunch of options. I'm just going to stick with my rectangle for now, and you can see there's a white fill and a red stroke at 10 pixels. If I want to change the stroke, I can just click and drag to change it. And you can see that when I hover over, it gives me the little hand with an arrow pointing left and right, and that tells me that I can click and drag. Or I can simply click inside and press whatever stroke size I want, in this case 10. So now I'm just going to go down and drag in my composition to create a shape. And you can see I can, you know, make whatever kind of rectangle I want. If I hold down shift while dragging, it's going to make it into a perfect square. So let's go ahead and make a square that is my my shape, and I've got a stroke of 10 in the red, and I've got the white fill. Now there's a bunch of things you can do to this. You can certainly use the selection tool, or hold on control to get the selection tool, to be able to adjust it. And you can see if I'm clicked on my shape layer, right, my anchor point is over here in the middle. If I click on the shape layer itself, I can click on this edge and resize it. Notice that it's resizing it relative to the anchor point, right? And that's really important here. So relative to the anchor point. I'm going to press Control Z to undo that. So it's the same for the top, right? Relative to the anchor point. If I click on the rectangle itself, the contents in this rectangle itself, then I can actually, the anchor point's in the middle here, and I can change it again relative to that anchor point. So what I'm trying to say is with shape layers, you've actually got the inside shape and you've got the shape layer itself. And those are two very different things. And we're going to talk about that in a second. But what you can do within a shape layer is create multiple shapes. So I can create another rectangle that's here. Now the problem with this is that if you hold down shift, it doesn't always make it into the shape that you want, but let's say I want to keep it as another square. Now I could do that, so I could try to eyeball it, or I could make it like this, or if I want to undo this, press Control Z, can click on the rectangle, and then I can simply duplicate this, right? So I can press Control C and then Control V, and that's going to create a second rectangle here, right? The problem with this, of course, is that I've got a rectangle. That this rectangle is the same thing, right? So and that's really probably not what I want. So I'm going to go through here and simply make a similar rectangle, and I can always change my dimensions to be the same size. So if I go ahead and make my my rectangle here, or my square here. Now, if I want to resize these, if I want to resize it from the shape layer, right, I can hold on the selection tool and notice that, again, relative to the anchor point, it's resizing this, right? So it's always resizing relative to the anchor point. And if I hold down shift again, it'll keep it as a square, retain the original aspect ratio. And of course, you can move the anchor point around, so it can, if I use my pan behind tool, I can move the anchor point into, let's say, the center or the center bottom here. And when I hold down control and shift, or sorry, when I go to my selection tool and resize, hold down shift, notice how it does it relative to that anchor point. So I can actually make it look like it's zooming in from perspective if I want to. Okay, that's fine. And notice I've got these two rectangles here within this same piece. I can also go through, of course, and resize this individual rectangle. So I can go through here and make this one smaller, again, relative to this anchor point. If I wanted to change that, I'd have to actually move the this anchor point down again to resize relative to this piece. So here I could make a big square and a small square. Again, if I go back to the main shape layer and resize, it's going to resize again relative to that anchor point. So it's just not going to look quite right. So that's what you can do within a shape layer. I'm going to delete the second rectangle out. Just click on it and press delete. Notice that you can transform the entire shape layer. So you can move the anchor point, you can change the position, scale, rotation, opacity. You can also change them for the individual shapes within here. So I can animate my stroke or my shape. So let's actually, if I go through and, I can't redo this, but so let's make another shape layer within here. Okay, so I've got another square. So rectangle one, rectangle two, right? So rectangle one, I can animate my fill to go from white in the beginning to 2 seconds in. I'm gonna make that red. So I'm gonna pick up my eyedropper and I'm gonna click on that red. Okay, so that's shape one. And then let's say I wanna do the opposite for rectangle two. So at this point, I'm going to change my stroke and I'm going to animate the color of the stroke here, and that's going to be that'll be red. Let's say here I want it to be red as well, but at this point, let's say I want this to change to white. So what I've got then, if I just press U, so I can see these two, and notice how it actually gives me the color values here, so I can actually stretch these out and compare them. I press spacebar, one turns completely red, one turns completely white. So you can animate all of these cool things within that shape layer. And that's a pretty interesting way to go about it. But I'm gonna go ahead and delete rectangle two. And I'm gonna go ahead and just reduce the shape layer down. Notice that when the shape layer is open, I've got these semi-transparent or grayed out keyframes, which says something in this content is animated. And then I can either scroll through to find it. It's down here, right? But again, you'd have to scroll through, or of course you can just press U, which is going to give you the elements that are animated. So, okay, so that's one way to do a shape. I'm going to show you a few other shapes here that are pretty cool. So if I click and hold down and go to my rounded rectangle, notice I can draw a rounded rectangle. If I press the up and the down arrow at the same time, the up arrow here, I make it more round. If I press the down arrow, it makes it more square. I'm just holding the down arrow down to change this. So that gives you some really interesting definition there. And of course, you can go through and change these elements as you want to. Let's change this this fill so that we can really see what these things are. Okay, so let's go through and make some more shapes. There's my ellipse. So if I click and I hold, Notice I can make an ellipse by holding down shift at the same time. I get a perfect circle. Notice that in this case, it's within the same shape layer, right? So I've got rectangle one, rectangle two, which is this piece here, and then I've got my shape layer. So let's actually make a new one. Let's say I don't want to animate them all at once. If I click out, so here the shape layer is selected, you can see there's this bounding box. If I click out, and then let's say I want to make a polygon, notice how it makes a new shape layer. And again, so it starts at three, if I move up, goes to four sides, five sides, six sides, pressing the up arrow, and then down makes it fewer. So I can actually make a pretty complex shape if I want to. Okay, so and you can see this is on top of the other. So if you wanted to have shape layers where you had shapes on top of one another, shape layer two is on top of shape layer one. If I click and drag this on top, then shape layer one is on top of shape layer two. Just like there, each layer is a piece of paper on top of one another, right? Now if I removed the stroke entirely from shape layer one, from this rectangle, right, this rectangle here, if I take out that fill entirely, so if I want to change this to be transparent, I just have to alt click. You see if I hold over, it gives me an alt click. So I can hold down alt and click through this. Okay, now it's going to give me a gradient. And I can open that to change the type of gradient, right? I can click in here to make these different colors. Let's say here I want this to be a red. You can see that makes it red, whatever, right? I can alt click again, which will give it a different kind of gradient, a radial gradient, and I can change my type of gradient there. Notice how cool these effects can be. Click again, it makes it no fill at all, so it's transparent. So now if I move my shape layer around, you can see what's underneath it, anyway, etc. So this is just to give you an idea of what we really want to have with these different shapes. So I've got these two shape layers on top of one another. You can also do this with a star. If I wanted to make a star, notice this is going to make another shape because neither of these is selected. So I'm going to create a star here, and I can make more. If I want to make like a little sun or something, or I can make it really really simple. If I want to do more religious symbol or a fun symbol, right? So it's a seven-pointed star, etc., right? And again, just like the regular polygon, the triangle is where it defaults to, right? So you can do all sorts of really really cool things here with shapes and layering shapes on top of one another, and that's one way to work with that tool. Okay, that's fine. So I'm going to go ahead and make some of these invisible because we don't really need to work with them here. So I'm going to actually remove the visibility. So I just clicked and dragged on these little eyeballs to make them invisible. And now let's look at a different way of doing this, and that's to play with solids. And you're going to work with solids a lot. So I'm going to go to Layer, New, Solid. And I'm just going to make a white solid that's the composition size. The composition is 1920 by 1080. You can make it any size you want, but you can always resize it, so you might as well make it the comp size. And it's white right now, okay, so it's very simple. And you can go to the selection tool and you can resize it, again, relative to the anchor point. And again, you can hold down Shift, and it will preserve the original aspect ratio, which is 16:9. So it doesn't make it a square, it's the original aspect ratio. So that's a really handy dandy tool if I want to make a little vignette or something in there. But in this case, I want to show you how to use the shape tool in a different way. So I've got this solid, and what I want to do here is make a mask, and I'm going to make a rounded rectangle, or I don't know, I guess I can make an ellipse or something like that, a mask here. So I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to make a circle. I'm going to make this a perfect circle. Now, the interesting thing about this is that actually hasn't removed the solid. If I click on inverted, you can see it does the opposite. So what this has done is it's basically taken kind of like a piece of paper and held it over everything but the shape, which is the shape of this circle. So I've got like a piece of paper with a circle cut out of it that reveals this white solid that's underneath. If I click on inverted, what I have is a little piece of paper that's a circle, and it hides just what's in the circle. And the cool thing about this is that you can actually move this around. So I can move my mask around, and in this case, what's gonna happen, it's actually moving the whole solid, right? You can see that this is the red, not the yellow of the mask. If I wanna move the mask, I can click on these individual tools. So I'm gonna click on this little box here, and hold on shift, and click on the other little bounding boxes, or these other little points of what's called a path. And then I can move this around. Oops. So now I can click all of these, and I'm gonna hold on the path and let go of shift, and then move this around. And you can see you can see is how this is revealing a part of that solid. Now imagine if this wasn't just a solid, imagine if this was copy or something like this. I can actually take this mask and do something really, really cool with it. In fact, you can animate this. So if I move this over to the side, I can go to the mask path and I can change the shape, or I can obviously transform the white solid and move the solid over, but let's actually just animate the path. So it's here. At this point in time, let's make that at zero, it's there. And then at 3 seconds in, I want it to be, I'm gonna hold on shift again to grab all of these points, and I'll show you why in a second. So I've got all of these points. Now I'm gonna drag it over. Maybe I'll drag it over, I'll just straight over here maybe. So if I start, what this does is it reveals a piece. Now, again, this can be over anything. It can be over a copy, anything. A mask can be on any different type of layer. So it allows you to reveal certain parts. The other cool thing about this is, let's say I want to have another kind of mask on this solid. So I'll just make a new solid. I'm gonna keep this solid, or maybe I'll make a new one, but I can add the solid again. So I can add a second solid in here, same size. And now let's make a different kind of mask. So let's say I'm gonna start with a star, which is kind of fun. Okay, so now I've got this star here. I'm gonna move it around. But now let's say I'm gonna select out here. Let's say I just wanna select this one point. Now I'm gonna zoom in, and you can zoom in with the zoom tool, or you can usually just use the scroll wheel on your mouse. So you can see that I've got these little bounding points here. So what if I want to animate this path? So let's say I go down here and I animate the path. And a few seconds in, I want to actually make this point move. So I'm going to go to my selection tool. I'm going to click on this point here. Oops. And I can actually drag this out and move it. You can also go through and distort certain parts of this. And what's really cool about this is that you can do this with other points as well. So I'm gonna hold down spacebar to move it around. It gives you that, changes the move tool. It's another handy dandy little thing here. But I can also alter these other pieces, or I can add new ones. I can go through and add a point here and add a point here with the pen tool, and then I can go to my selection button and go through and actually distort, oops, this whole piece. Or excuse me, I'm going to click on the solid, not the mask, but on the solid, so that the mask is deselected, because when you click on the mask, it selects all of these points. So then I'm gonna go, when I hover over it, you can see it changes the icon, and then I can go through and I can alter this piece. And the same one with this, I can alter this piece out. And again, I can distort it however I want. So you can do all sorts of really, really cool things here. So I'm gonna zoom out here, I'm going to click on my zoom tool, and I'm going to, oops, zoom out here, and put this back in the middle. If I go to fit, it'll just put it in the middle. But so you can see how this actually changes the mask itself. And you can't really do this with shapes, but it allows you to do some really, really cool stuff over time. And notice, of course, that again, this could reveal not a white solid, remember this isn't a shape, it's just whatever's behind this mask, but it could reveal copy or something like that. So you can get some really, really cool effects here. Okay, so that's working with masks, which I think is a really fantastic way to work with a lot of different things in After Effects. But I'm gonna bring back, maybe I'll bring back a different shape. So here's a very simple shape again. I wanna look at effects now that we can put on this this shape, or that we could put on a solid, it doesn't really matter. So I'm gonna go to Effect. I have to click on my shape layer, and then go to Effect, and I can do all sorts of different things here. You can see I can do some distortions, I can do some color corrections, I can add noise, I can stylize something. There's all sorts of really, really cool things I can do, and I would suggest playing with these as you can. And now I'm gonna just go to color correction. So let's say you didn't wanna do this in the shape layer itself, but let's say you wanted to change the color of this object from the tint, as opposed to, so from an effect, meaning in your effect controls, rather than in the shape layer itself, because it's kind of a pain in the butt to go in here and then go into your shape and then go into your fill and change the color, right? Instead, what if I wanna just take and map these colors? So this right now has changed it to, I've got a black stroke and a white inside, it automatically changes to black and white. But I can really easily change this. So let's say, and again, this is animatable. So at this point, let's say 3 seconds in, I'm gonna go ahead and change both these. And notice that you can change the amount of tint. So you can give something a sepia tone or whatever you want. So at 3 seconds, it's there. And then at 5 seconds, let's go and change the black to a blue. And let's change white to maybe a lighter blue or something simple. Okay, so as I go, notice how very, very subtly it begins to change this piece. You can see the keyframes by clicking on U, and then you can see exactly what it does. And of course, you can change different pieces here with these keyframes. You can also change the amount to tint. So we can actually have this go down by 50% rather than by 100%. So it's just a very, very subtle change here. So we go from white to a very subtle, in some ways, tint of this piece. So that's a really, really cool way to work with things. You can also do this with copy. So if I go back to my, I'll just add some new copy in here. So let's say I've got this. Let's go ahead and type in some copy here. I'm gonna select out, and I'm gonna type some copy. So hi there class, whatever, something stupid. And let's say I go back to the same piece. Let's say I just click on my effect here, my tint, right? I'm gonna press Control C to copy this tint. And then I'm gonna go to my my text layer, and I'm going to paste it in. So if I go to U here, you can see that I've got the same exact piece. So of course this middle was hollow, right? Not black. So if I go here and I want to make that white on the inside, you can see that that's going to change it the same way, right? So now I've got white and black, and now everything is going to tint the same amount. Right at the same time, right? And now, of course, that's changing first, and that's because it is the keyframes are placed at a different spot, right? Because it's been pasted in differently. I can go ahead and I can move this effect over to make it happen at the same time, right? So I can move this here if I choose to make it happen earlier. I'm just clicking and dragging. You can see how beautifully variable this is. Now, if I wanted to, when I pasted this in, if I wanted to be at the same spot, I would have just wound back to the beginning and then pasted it in, it would have been at the exact same spot. So anyway, that's the way you can use tints to make some really cool pieces here. So I'm gonna pull this off. Maybe I'll make a new one. So I'll make this invisible again. And let's go ahead and add another text layer. Hello again, and let's add another shape layer. Okay, again, I'm gonna control click to change my type of fill. Okay, so I've got these two pieces. So let's say I wanna do something different here. Let's say I wanna do a gradient or something. So I can go into Effect, and I go to Ramp, which is somewhere in here. Ramp. And again, you can see that this defaults to black and white, but I can easily change that. So I can change that to a red, and I can leave this at a white or change it to a different color, whatever I want. And again, this is animatable, so I can change this. So at this point, I can, let's say I want to start, let's say I want to make a, I don't know, a sunrise, right? I can start this here, and I can end it at a different color. So let's say 3 seconds in, I'm going to have this start at a blue, and I'm going to have the end color be a lighter blue or something, or maybe a darker blue, whatever you want. Or maybe a lighter blue would be nice. Okay, so I move from a very simple white and red to a beautiful noonday, right? So something very, very simple that allows you to do something quite beautiful in effect. And remember, this can be done in the copy as well. So if I open my shape layer here, I've got my effects, I can copy them all at once, and there's only one here, or I can just take the effect itself, the gradient, so Control C, and notice I'm doing this from the beginning, and I can go to my hello again, and at the beginning, press Control V, and this adds in my ramp. Right. Now notice here that the red is different, and the reason is that the start of the ramp is the same. So if I move my shape layer down, notice that it changes. So you can actually have this animate up and change color simply because of the place of the ramp. Now if I want it to look the same as this, of course I can change my the location, the y-axis of the ramp itself. So I'm dragging this to the left and the right to move it, and you can see what's moving is this anchor point up and down. So that gives you an idea of how this works. So what you should think about when you're working with effects is where exactly is the effect applied and how is it applied? You should play with all of these things, because if it doesn't look exactly like you want, chances are you're just missing something really small in this piece. Okay, so let's do one more effect to give you some idea of the possibilities here. I'm gonna toss the white solid, I'm gonna go back to my project and toss a white solid behind all of this so we can see some interesting effects. This is not something I would normally do. Normally I would work in 3D instead, but I wanna give you some idea of how to make a 3D effect without actually using 3D. So I'm gonna go to my shape layer, this one, and I'm gonna add an effect that is a drop shadow. And there's a bunch of different really cool pieces we can do here. We're going to work with a couple here. I just can't remember where anything is. So I'm going to do a drop shadow from perspective. And you can see that there's this little shadow here. And I'm going to make sure that it moves a little bit further. So I'm going to change my distance. So you can see there's my shadow behind. And I'm going to make it really soft so it kind of looks like a shadow. And maybe I'll drop the darkness down a little. So that actually looks a lot like a shadow, right? And I can move this around, of course, too, and the shadow moves with it. And notice as I move it, though, the ramp moves as well. So I would want to animate my ramp at the same time if I'm gonna move this piece, if I want it to stay the same color. Now, if I don't wanna do this, I can do this as a precomposition, and I'll show you that in a second. So right now I've got this piece and my hello again, I can do the same thing. I can add a drop shadow to that. So I'm gonna I can copy and paste it, or I can do it the same way. So notice my last effect is here. but I'll go to perspective, drop shadow. Let's increase the distance. Let's increase the softness. And let's make it a little lighter. So you can see I get a really cool 3D effect without actually having to worry about making this in three dimensions. So we're gonna worry about three dimensions later. So if you wanted to animate all of this at the same time without actually changing the ramp, that's when you use precompositions. So I'm gonna pull off my white solid here. So you can't actually see that there is a drop shadow because it's just black on black, right? What I'm gonna do is go back into my sample for class. I'm gonna go here at this point, and I'm gonna add a white solid back in here. Now, I don't want it behind all of this stuff, although I mean, it would be fine, but that copy's white, so it doesn't really look right. So I'm just gonna move this down so that it only appears at this point. Okay, so now I've got white here. Now what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna drag the sample for class composition in on top of this. So that composition itself can be part of this piece. So you can see, and you can see as I move this, it changes the color, right? So let's say I want it to be here. So I move in, and that's what it looks like. Okay. Now, but I want to move this, right? I want to have this come in, and then maybe I'll have it come in on one side and move from the other. So let's say at this point, I want this to be on the left side, and then I want to move it in to the right. So I can actually animate the position of this itself. So at this point, I'm going to have the position animated here, and notice I can hold down shift to keep it linear. So I'm going to start there, and then I'm going to move in, and I'm going to drag this over. And this is going to move really fast, but you'll be able to see it. So you can see it moves, it changes colors as it moves. And that's not because I'm moving the ramp, but because the ramp is animated. So you can actually do some really, really cool things by embedding one composition into the other. Okay, so those are some kind of fun things you can do. Maybe I'll add another effect in here so you can just see another option. So I'm going to add an effect here that is I'm going to do a bevel. If I can find it, perspective, bevel alpha. And this is on my hello again thing. If you can see this now, notice I've got an edge here. So this actually looks like it is, I'm gonna change that out. So for this effect, I can take this off by clicking on the effect button. You can see it looks flat. Now it looks like it's in three dimensions. And again, you can animate all of this. So I can go through and I can change the color of the light color of the alpha. I can also do how thick I want the edge to be. So if I drag this up, I can make it look really three-dimensional, or I can make it look really flat, all sorts of things there. So you can see that that actually gives you a really cool effect. And you can do this the same with the shape. So I can go through here, effect, bevel alpha. And okay, that doesn't look so great, you know, because the edge is too small here. So let's ramp up that edge a little bit. Let's make it really thick. And you can see that this actually makes it look three-dimensional. So you can get some very, very cool effects very easily just by using these stock effects from After Effects. And of course, as you move, it really makes it beautiful, really, really changes, makes it look a lot more professional. So that's one way to worry about these kinds of things. Okay, so I wanna give you a couple more, or maybe let's just do one more effect here. So I'm gonna go ahead and I'm gonna drag another solid down. And notice that I just keep using solid after solid after solid. And the reason is that solids are the easiest thing to animate or to add effects to in some way. So here I'm gonna go to effect and then generate. And I'm gonna go to grid, although there's all sorts of really cool things here. You could do a fractal pattern where you could have all sorts of really, really cool things here. You can change the type of equation. You can choose all sorts of different different pieces here, so you can alter all sorts of different aspects to make some cool effects. Fractal's a little crazy for me, but again, it's animatable, so you can do all sorts of interesting things here. You can also do some really fun ones and generate like grid or fill, or you know, there's all sorts of amazing things you can do. I'm gonna work on grid here because it's really, really simple. And what this did is it create, I'm gonna make everything else invisible. What this did is it made basically a graph, and I've got anchor points here, so I can drag these in and make a graph. So this is great for when you're working on, when you're actually trying to create a grid or a graph where you wanna have something animated. And of course you can make this smaller if you choose to. If you go down like this, that would be a great way to show some infographics for your project. And you can ramp this, all sorts of things you can do with any of this. Okay, so I wanna talk finally about presets. I'm gonna throw another solid on here, and I'm gonna throw in some more copy. Well, let's just leave the solid on here for now. So I've got the solid that's white. I wanna talk about presets, and when you click on this effects and presets button, the really cool thing about After Effects is that it comes with something called Adobe Bridge, which has all sorts of presets that are viewable for you to mess with. So sometimes it takes a little bit to load, but instead of going through all of these, what I'm going to suggest you do is click on this button here, this drop down, and I want you to go to Browse Presets. And what that's going to do is it's going to load up Adobe Bridge. And this is what Bridge looks like. So you can see there's a bunch of different things that you can do here. I'm going to simply go to, so I don't know, you can go to something like shapes, or you can go to special effects, all sorts of really amazing things you can do here. Maybe we can go to backgrounds, let's see what's in here. So here's a cool one, blocks. I think it's might be Desperate Housewives that uses something like this, but we can play with it. So I'll double click on this, and it's going to apply this to the solid. Okay, so it immediately applied it here, and Bridge goes into the background. And so as I move in, if I'm going to put rest U here on this, I can actually see that I've got all sorts of things moving around here. And in Effect Controls, I've got all of these interesting pieces here. I've got Fractal Noise, I've got Minimax, and I've got Tritone. So you can play with all of these to change this, but if I move forward, what you can see is that this is doing some really, really cool things. Now, if I want to bring, if I bring something back here, so let's say my shapes, right? You can't see them, obviously, right? But if I go ahead and I change my white solid to be a different opacity, right? You can actually have a very cool effect on top of your shapes or your copy or whatever. And you know, you can change any of this stuff, and you can animate any of this stuff. So you can make this a different color, you can make this a different color. You know, so you can really do all sorts of things here. You can even blend it in. So that's blended into black, or I can blend it in a little bit less. So let's say I change this to back to 100% opacity, but it blends with whatever's behind it, right? So you can do all sorts of really, really interesting things here. You can expand this out, you can repeat it, all sorts of things, right, to mess with this. So let's delete this effect out. I'm just gonna click on effects and press delete. And now let's go and try a different one. So I'm gonna go back to Bridge. And we can actually preview these without adding them in, although sometimes depending on how powerful the computer is, it might actually stall and not be happy with you when you do this. But you can see that it kind of previews it here on the side to give you some idea of what it's actually going to look like. So lightning bend. So notice how this starts to look a lot like some of the films that you know and love in terms of their effects or their credit sequences, all of that. And again, all of this can be added to any layer. It can be added to a solid, it can be added to copy, etc. Okay, so that's fine. That's a really kind of fun way to mess with it. I'm gonna go back to presets. And instead of messing with the solid, I'm gonna go through and I'm gonna make some copy here. So let's go through and, hello there. Okay, same thing we've always done. I'm gonna highlight this, or actually I can just undo that. I'm gonna click on the text layer so that it's selected here. And again, I'm gonna go to bridge or effects and then browse presets. So go to text. You can really play with some interesting things here. You can do something simple with animate in, like, I don't know. None of these are really all that simple, but you could do fade up by characters when it, so you can see that that comes in. But you could also do something really complex, like raining in, where you can see that the characters actually fall down from the sky. So, you know, center spiral, all of these. So there's all sorts of really interesting pieces you can do. I'm going to just go to, or there's typewriter, which is a classic, but I'm gonna do raining characters. And you can see, again, if I click on, if I press U, it's gonna give me my animations here. So I'm gonna press spacebar, and you can see that as this animates in. Now notice this green bar down here. What this does is it shows me how much is actually rendered. So this is actually supposed to be 2 seconds, but it's taking more like 10 seconds because the computer's being slow right now. But now that this is blue, you can really see what it's supposed to look like. Right, then it slows down again when the green bar stops. So anyway, that's a really wonderful way to work with presets to make your composition a lot more complex, a lot more beautiful, without knowing an incredible amount about After Effects. So I hope you enjoyed this. I look forward to seeing how you play.